All right. If beauty could be measured in a ruler, yours would be to infinity and beyond. And no, I am not Buzz Lightyear. It's just that your smile adds so much extra to the ordinary that it's some extraordinary ways it can be seen light years away across the galaxy. So due to that fact, by the poetical teachings of a Gemini, I want to take the time to get to know you from the neck up. Gradually through time, I'm always back from the neck down. I know it sounds vaguely cliche, it's just that I want us to be eye to eye before we can introduce hip to hip. Don't get me wrong, the idea of playing mommy and daddy with you behind the sheets have several times crossed my mind, and it is completely encrypted into my molecular cells. After all, I am a male. However, I must resist these outrages and the malistic urges. Let's face it, in a logical sense, sex will be the dessert, and the relationship will be the main meal. And just as I was told growing up hundreds of times, having the dessert for the main meal can spoil the appetite, and as for me, I want mine in the right order. Look past the dark pigmentation of these pupils of mine, and you will see no deception in these words I speak. For I was born to spit the truth, and truth of the matter is, it is not my fault for exhibiting such feelings. What had happened was, I simply tripped and fell for your love. Cause for your love, I would do the impossible, the illogical, the unimaginable for your love. I would go swimming across the Atlantic Ocean, butt naked, with some sharks and million people from my mind just for a kiss of yours. For your love, I would go to school to be a sculptor. Go back to school to be an astronaut. Then fly me to the moon so I can carve the moon into your portrait because it is said to be a rock. For your love, I would go to a neurologist with your picture. Get the face imprinted to my neurons so every time I fall asleep, I will be able to process your face in my dreams. For your love, I am starting to fall in love with you in such a strong-footed manner that I'm willing to lick every step you take off the ground so the other guy can pick up your smell. So now, let's reciprocate this. As some form of an assurance of my love to your love, knowing that you would love me too, I want to implant the tracking chip inside of you so I can hear every move. Let's reciprocate it further. As some form of assurance of my love to your love, knowing that you would love me too. Get this. I wanna wait when you fall asleep. Get a tattoo artist to tattoo my name across your stomach in bold letters saying JOHN'S, Johns, with an arrow pointing down south at my favorite property of yours. Okay. I know it's a bit eccentric and wrong, but by the melodious blues of Al Green, love can make you do wrong, but it can also make you do right. But on the real though, for your love, I would finally learn to love myself. Because it is almost impossible to be loved without first loving yourself. I love you to the part that I want to break a piece of my rib to sharpen the tip as a writing utensil. Scratch out a piece of my stomach and use it as a parchment. Slice my wrist so I can use the blood as ink. Just so I can write you a poem with the truest authentication and embodiment of writing means to write from the soul. It's just that I love you more than my tongue can tell. I love you with the passion of a thousand burning hearts combined into my one simple heart. If it is too much to love you in this manner, please, you think I can have your sister's number?
Yes, you better preach, John. You better preach. Thank you. One more time, please give it up for John Gibson. Ladies and gentlemen, the moment you all have been waiting for, we are going to begin this relationship panel. We are going to give him some good topics, some good conversation, and we encourage you all to ask questions, to listen, and to just be interactive. This is a group discussion, okay? So I'm going to introduce the panelists. They're going to come up and they're going to introduce themselves. They're going to give you more information about them. So the first one is Mr. Harold. Oh, they're right there. Hello. And then we have, once you come, you can all stand up here, and then I'll give you the mic one by one. You'll introduce yourself. We have Dr. Tasha. Please, Dr. Tasha. We have Miss Tiffany Knowles. Please give her a round of applause. And I think we have King Kevin. Yes, so I'll give you the mic. We already know who you are. Yeah. I'll send you the mic. Give us a little more detailed information.
Yes. I've read two books. My first book was called Courage to Believe. Second one is Seven Types of Queens, King Desire. I also have a documentary called Courage to Believe, which I named after my first book. And also our nonprofit organization, Courage to Believe International. We teach the youth how to play chess. So if you guys need a mentor or a program to help with the youth in your community, please contact me. And we also getting ready to start a reading program called Through Our Lens. So we're going to teach the youth how to read, write, and publish their own books. Because I think it's very important. Matter of fact, I know it's very important that the youth write their own future instead of the criminal justice system.
Good evening. My name is David Harrell. I'm owner of Harrell's Fine Fashion, the men's clothing store, university. I'm married. I have four kids, eight grandkids, and my youngest child is 2.5 years old. Also, this is my fourth marriage, so I think I bring a lot to the table.
Yes, sir.
The rules and the ghosts and the kids and the wannabes, I have
made it through everything. But
hello, everyone. My name is Tiffany Knowles. I am a professor at a local university here. I am the author of Hola America, Guts, Grit, Grind, and Further Traits in the Successful American Immigrant. I am the love child of two amazing immigrants. My mom is Jamaican and my father is Bahamian. And so we pulled from our experiences to write this book. My father and I co-wrote it. And I would love to share with you my thoughts on immigrant love and love from the African-American and Caribbean diaspora experience that I talk a lot about in my book, and I'll be talking a little bit about that today. Hello, you guys. My name is Maggie Fresh Frederick. I am the CEO and founder of Discover the Beauty Women Empowerment. What we basically do in the community is to empower women to pursue their purpose with passion through their gifts and their calling that God placed on the inside of them. I also have a book coming out this spring called 21 Days of Beauty Empowerment, where we go into different scriptures, different, you know, nuggets of what beauty truly is. And I would be happy to share it with you guys on tonight. And I'm also single, praise the Lord.
Hey! Hi, y'all, I'm Dr. Tasha. I am the doctor of drive-by therapy, a talk show that I do also on 105.1 FM on Sunday nights with Jill Tracy. And let's see what else I do. I really am a psychologist, and I come to your home and do therapy on the same couch that you possibly were having an argument on with your partner or one of your wives. Who knows? You never know. I can also help you with premarital counseling if you are interested in that as well. We're going to get into the questions. Can we do that? All right. And audience, can you please think of something and then raise your hand and I will come to you and I will ask you exactly what it is. Ask them exactly what it is that you would like to know. All right, let's start off with something light. Let's start off with, who taught you about love and relationships?
Can I address that first?
Yes.
Okay, so my parents taught me a lot. Okay, so my parents taught me a lot about what not to do in a relationship and a marriage. So my mom is a very domineering, go-getter, self-starting Jamaican woman. She's very own way. She's very stubborn.
but she is amazing. I call her a Renaissance woman. My dad is a very mild-mannered, kind, gracious, but more docile man. And I loved them, but I did not love their interactions growing up. They taught me a lot about how I should not speak to my husband, to be.
Why don't you be more specific?
Specifically?
Yeah, what would you not do? What are you not now not gonna do?
So specifically, I remember one day we went on a trip and I took my friend from high school with me on this trip, and she heard my mom say something to my dad that was pretty embarrassing. He was helping her take something out of the car and I think he dropped it and it broke. And she was, my mom said, I never asked you to go and take that from the car. Who asked you to go and get that from the car? No one asked you to touch that. So it was really, really just, she spat fire at him. And my friend said, well, your mom speaks like that to your dad? What? So that was one thing that I knew. Well, I didn't know that it was bad, but I remember hearing her telling me that that's not how you speak to a man. And that was, I guess that was in middle school, high school, and I thought, well, then that's probably not the way I should do it. And then later on, I've, you know, in watching television and seeing different kinds of things on media, I noticed that we live in a culture where we are bombarded with the wrong kind of message of how to treat men. I used to love to watch King of Queens, and there's a really brazen Carrie Heffernan and a very subservient Doug Heffernan who's always afraid of making the wrong move around her. And so I thought, that's not how I want to do it.
Thank you, Tiffany. Can we give it up for that? Mr. Harrow, one question. How did you find out about, how did you learn about love and relationships?
Learning from the street. I grew up with a mother and a father, but you know they were working. My mother was a maid, my dad was a lawn service man, so I never really had a chance. They never really raised me. So everything I learned it from the street, all the bad stuff and all the good stuff, it was from the street.
No, I got it. What, can you give an example that you learned, even if it was something that was not so great, of how to love or how to be in a relationship?
Well, I remember my mother telling me, she said, if you get a girl pregnant, you have to marry her. So that's where my first marriage came from.
That's real.
I was dating a girl, and this is, you know, I was a school bus driver, and she was a scooter. So now I'm part of being in jail now, that was, you know, back then, talking 40 years ago. And so she got pregnant.
She was a high school student.
She was a high school student, I was a school bus driver. Yeah, it was her senior year.
I needed to be her senior year. 18,
yeah. Okay. Yeah, and I was just on the military.
We got it, Mr. Harold.
Yeah.
We got it. Thank you for being so honest. Yeah. King Kevin, how did you learn about
relationship? I learned about love and relationship from a couple different ways. One, just like Mr. Harold from the streets. I mean, I watch men from my uncles to neighbors beat up their wives and girlfriends, you know, like they stole something. So it left me shell-shocked as a young one. And so at the same time, growing up in the 80s, you know, I grew up just a very white, you know, people like Patti LaBelle, Marvin Gaye, you know, Teddy Pendergrass. So that's how I learned about how to treat a lady. Going to the 90s, listening to Joe, watching the TV shows like The Cosby Show, especially the Cosby Show and what's other than Family Matters, and seeing, you know, the love being exchanged between one another. That's how I learned how to love and what is right to agree and what is wrong. Because today, when you're watching TV, reality shows, I mean, love is pretty much what you can buy someone or what you can do for someone, you know, because in relationships today, what I've realized is that it's more about how you can use someone rather than how you can edify and uplift the other person. And so watching these things, that's how I learned about love. And
you spoke about domestic violence, which let's not get over that because it's like one in five couples really have to deal with it, right? How did you know that that was an inappropriate thing and that you didn't want to continue that, what you saw?
I mean, seeing blood female's clothes. I know that was right.
Oh, that's real.
You know, that's, I mean, seriously, I talked about it in my first book, you know. So, and I'm glad you asked that question first, because it taught me to want to be a better man, because all I seen was abuse and violence, you know, growing up. Thank God I didn't grow up that way, you know. I've never caught a domestic violence charge, never put my hand on a woman. I might have pushed, you know what I'm saying, out of the heat of the moment, but I've never...
Restrained?
I mean, you know, restrained.
A little passion.
Hey, things are hot and heated, you know, but thank God.
Ms. Mandy Fresh, I'm going to ask you a different question. How do you... how do you show someone that you're interested?
Okay, I'm going to try to answer as best as, because I'm still single, so apparently something's not working.
You can process through that. You can process through that.
Okay, how do you show someone that you're interested?
How do you?
How do I? See, I don't want to lie. I've been single for a while. Ten years, first floor. 10 years. 10 years no date.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But it's by choice.
Okay.
And I'm happy I did that.
Okay.
Only because, you know, sometimes we get in certain relationships and we're looking for that person to fulfill us. And for me, I had to go through a journey with God to find myself, to love myself. So I can't really give you an honest answer only because I was working on me first. You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes we get in relationships and we're looking for that significant other to figure out how to draw that person. I would say first, you need to draw God first. You need to build a foundation on God. Know who you are. Know what you like. Know what you don't like. So when the significant other does come, you'll know what you look for, because you know what you won't take.
Okay,
you know
what's your top three things that you like? Top three.
So attract, I mean, smell good. Of course, you want to smell nice. Yeah. Praise the Lord. You don't want to be saying. A good, you know, smile at the guy, you know. I have a pretty smile, so I'm a smile. If I'm not interested, I'm not smiling.
When you're smiling.
When I'm smiling, that means I'm yes. When I'm not, I have my game face on, that means back up. Praise the Lord, not today.
Thank you, Miss Lady. Tiffany, how does someone know that you're interested?
Okay, so how does someone know that I'm interested? I am very talkative with them. I'm very conversant. I'm very interested in being intellectually stimulated, so I'll talk with you at length, and the hours will go by, and that's how I know for sure I'm interested. And I think I let on that that is how I'm interested as well.
Mr. Harrell, different question. What are you the most attracted to? Like, what type of thing is it? Obviously not external. I'm not going to ask you to tell me the external appearance that attracts you. What is it about a woman that attracts you the most?
A quiet woman that's quiet and reserved and just it, quiet and reserved.
I love that you said that, because a lot of the introverts in the world, you know, get a bad rap. What is it about a quiet woman that attracts you? What is it about that?
I would like to get to know her, see what's, you know, a lot of ladies that you know them by just looking at them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's kind of mysterious to them. So I want
to put in the work to get to know. Oh, I like that.
Oh, that's not,
I got that.
Yeah.
A quiet woman. King Kevin.
Same question. And the question was, how do I show...
No, sorry.
What do I like?
That was her question. Okay. What are you the most attracted to about a woman?
There's so many things.
Top three, brother.
Top three. Definitely a woman that's graceful. You know, she doesn't have to boost and brag. You know, I love a confident woman. A woman that loves to pray, whether it's for herself or for her family. Definitely for me. I need prayer. Like, seriously, you know, nothing happens in the physical world unless it happens in the spiritual world first. And so I need a woman that understands that, you know, because I'm a warrior king. I want to take over things. I want to do things. So I need someone that can battle with me in the spiritual realm. Definitely, last but not least, a cooking queen. I love to eat good. You know, I love everybody around me to eat. Everybody work, everybody eat. That's my motto. So, yeah, those are three things.
So in your ideal relationship, long term, we can call it a miracle, you believe in marriage, yes?
I believe in marriage, of course.
In a week's time, 7 days, how long do you want this cooking? How many days in 7 days do you want this cooking today to cook? Because you got some strong 2 out of 7 days in the ring, but I'm wondering, what is that ideal? True story.
True story, definitely. I mean, she could cook twice a week, and I could cook the third time, or the fourth time.
Mr. Can you please get Mr. Harold is shaking his head. Mm-hmm.
Shake his head?
Speak to that.
I like to cook when I can.
You good with two? Three?
Three.
Ideal. How many times would you like
to cook? I mean, ideal, 3 times a week.
Okay. Two, you don't eat on the leftovers, the other?
Of course, okay. I mean, you know, today everyone's busy. Everyone has something going on. And if you're dealing with me, you better have something going on with your life. So you're not going to have time to be in the kitchen all day, all night. So I expect you to be productive and also to make sure that we are eating good. Because you can't depend on fast food to eat. And I think that's important to have healthy home-cooked meals. I like to eat home. I'm not, you know, I can't afford to go out and eat in restaurants, but I'd rather eat at home.
You said you're a mother to what he said? You sure?
Mr. Harris has something to say.
Well, I saw you shaking his head.
Okay, because I know a lot of guys like women that cook almost 5 to 7 days a week. You know, from a Haitian background, God knows, you know, every Haitian woman girl, that's all you do is cook, cook, cook. But in reality, because two people got to go to work, it's kind of hard for a woman to cook 5 to 7 days a week if two people want to work. That's just my opinion. Yeah.
Mr. Hill, tell me what that was immediately.
Well, for me, it's at least 5 days.
5 days.
At least 5 days. Especially on Sunday. Sunday dinner. Almost, you gotta have Sunday dinner.
Okay.
Invite everybody over. The Fridays, you can be off. Some Saturdays, but the rest of the week, you got to.
Now, you said she could clock out on Friday? She could clock out?
Yeah, on Friday.
Okay, eat out on Friday.
And now, Saturday.
Were you like a soup chef on those 5 days? Were you cutting up the onions and the peppers, or was she doing everything?
I do not cook at all.
Okay, gotcha.
And I don't even like to go to the grocery store.
You don't even like the groceries
there. I don't like to go to the store. But now, I wash.
You're clean.
I clean. I do everything inside and outside of the house. And she don't have to do anything. So,
okay.
And I wake up.
Honest answer.
I wake up at 5 o'clock every morning, study the Bible, get up, wash dishes, wash clothes, and do it all. So all she has left is to go. And she doesn't work.
Y'all ready for the next one?
Can I add something?
Yes, sir.
Truth be told, I'm going to be a future multi-billionaire, right? I may have 3-4 chefs in my kitchen. I've been speaking the future to existence. Now, I don't care how many chefs I have in my house, in the mansion, I would want my wife to cook for me directly.
I'm
gonna
with that. That's interesting. It's very interesting. I like to cook, so I think it is important to be able to cook for your man and serve your man. In terms of the amount of time that I have, Mr. Harold and I wouldn't work well together. You know, because I couldn't do 5 unless he was working and I didn't have to. That's the only time I could think that would work. But you like what you like. There's nothing wrong with that, sir. Okay, next question. What are your deal breakers? I want all 4 of you all to answer. What are your deal breakers? She went in. Y'all didn't hear that?
Say.
She said bad breath. Did y'all get that? Hygiene is important.
Halitosis.
Oh, okay. Breath mints
will just mask.
So the gums. They went to the gums. Okay. All right, here we go. Deal breakers, let's go.
I know we're not shy on
this. Okay, so I got it. I do not like addictions. I do not like addictions. So addictions to different vices, marijuana, pornography, alcohol.
You won't work with any of them. Gambling.
What?
No.
What about you to be financially responsible? No, absolutely.
What about a brother that's in recovery? I worked at a couple of rehab facilities. So if he's a recovering alcoholic, would you Okay, that's a common no. I think that's a no. That's a common no. Okay. Yeah. That's your thing. Addiction is can get dangerous because there are relapses. So that's what you don't want.
That's it.
But also, can I ask that? Does that mean you don't have an addiction of your own? Because there's a lot of secret addictions out there, like shopping, like food. Right. Okay, we don't discuss that.
I like chocolate chip cookies, but I use them in moderation.
Okay, without an addiction. I just want you to be able to bring to the table what you're wanting. That's a big deal. We do that sometimes.
I see.
We want something. But if you know, everybody doesn't have an addiction, but there is something that you may kind of
sure.
may have to work on. But you know what, you know what? Well done. That's your deal breaker. Who's next? What is your deal breaker?
Okay. My deal breaker is basically seeing where the man's spiritual foundation is. We can't go nowhere.
Can he have a relationship with God and not have gone to church since like Easter?
What does that mean?
Is this December? There are lots of people that have a relationship with God and haven't been to church since December. That's a real question.
Because I'm very active in church, that would be a problem for me. That would be a problem for me. Only because if God is number one for me, if you're saying you only go to church only on certain occasions, that kind of shows me where you are. Because for me, it's when you come together with a body of believers, you guys build each other up. So if you're not in church with people that can build you up, how can you say your relationship is tightened? Of course, your relationship with God is personal. I understand that. But at the same time, you know, the Bible does says, do not negate the body of believers. We build each other up. So how are you building yourself up if you're by yourself? One can put a thousand in the fight, but two can put
so what about, because this is getting interesting. Would you bring the brother to church that doesn't go? Like maybe he didn't like the church that he was going to, and you could introduce the church that he made.
That's different. If he went to church and he's in transition out of the church because he don't like where he's at, that's a different story. But if you're not in church, see, that's, everybody deal breaker is different. That's my deal breaker. Because the man is the head, right? The man is created after the glory of God. And if he's not in line with God, unfortunately your house won't be in line. What would be your vision? Because when a wife finds you, you know, when you find your wife, you gotta have a vision to present to her. So for me, is I'm not gonna get with a guy who don't know where they're going, who doesn't have a relationship with God, who can't hear from God. You don't know. No, I can't. That's my deal breaker, because I take that seriously, that the man is the head of a woman, and I believe if you have a relationship with God, that you know where we're going. I can't be with a man that don't know where he's going. If you're not in line with God, you can't know where you're going.
Does anybody have an offering plate? Offering plate to pass? Anybody have an offering plate? Okay.
Hey, I'm saying that's too strict.
Oh.
Say what? I'm saying it's too strict.
That's
too strict. It's
too
strict.
That's too strict for you, so this is your.
That's how you know.
Yeah. That's it. You're not. Don't speak that you don't go in front of him. She does not like you. Okay. Deal breaker.
Smoking.
Smoking what, sir?
Anything. And trust. I got to trust you.
Trust and smoking. Got it.
If I can't trust you, I can't be with you.
That's good.
So let me ask this question. Do you, when you start a relationship, do you give them 100% trust, or do you start at zero and build?
Build. No, because I'm a real open trusting soul.
Yeah.
I start out trusting you at the top.
Mm-hmm. So you give 100%?
Yeah.
Zero.
Day one.
I do too. Now you can lose it, but I give you 100%.
But now, see, now I trust you or I don't trust you. So there's no in between for me. So if I don't trust you, then it's over.
Now with like statistics show, like if you actually, as women do the 100% more often than men. Men do more than 0% and build. I got that? For instance, raise your hands for the males in the room. Who starts at 0% and builds? Who starts at men? Who starts at 100% and then takes it away? Women.
100% okay, down.
For the women, who starts at 100% and then they can go down? And then who starts at 0% and then go up? Okay, that's kind of half and half. Yes, sir, that's the same question.
Definitely. My deal breaker is, there's two things. Should I say two or just one?
It's your deal breaker.
All right. Well, one.
You can't wear a blazer like that. You can't answer twice. You can't do that.
I'm the queen, so I gotta ask permission.
Okay, absolutely.
I can't stand for a woman that doesn't have positive energy in the morning. Actually, anybody. No, male or female.
That's true.
Just come here and start the day complaining. smile in the morning or something positive. You know, that ain't happening. Not in my world. The second one is a woman that wears weaves 365 days a year.
Unconditionally without feeling like, well, if I don't have weave or if my hair is not permed, I'm not beautiful. So my hair is actually really natural, and I've learned to love every part of me just as natural as it can be. So now when a guy comes into my life, I'm so comfortable with myself that if I wear weave and he loves it, great. If I wear my cornrows and he loves it, great. If he doesn't love it, keep it moving. Because I want you to love me for just everything about me, whether it's pretty to you, pretty to me, not pretty to society. As long as I love it, there's nothing that anyone can tell me about it.
This woman is hard. Anybody else? Hold with the W. Yes, sir. What's your name?
My name is Elijah. The key to what King Kevin said was 365 with the weave. I understand that sometimes you want to switch it up or it makes you feel more luxurious and glamorous, and that's fine. But from my experiences, it kind of creates a bigger issue because when you're wearing it so much, I think it damages your real hair, right? Edges and things. So, constantly over time, now you're stuck where you have to wear the weave because now it's like repairing or you're, you know, hiding what's really going on, and then that becomes an addiction. I think that was one of the other questions, what's your addiction? So if the weave now becomes an addiction, so just my experiences.
Give it up for Elijah, that was real.
My name is Ronaldo, and I want to go back to the earlier young lady was talking about church. You know, an addiction is when you do something a whole lot, a lot of times. So if you go to church 7 days a week, that doesn't give you an opportunity to meet someone. 7 days, if you expect your man to also match you 7 days a week, go to church, I think 7 days a week is just a little bit too much.
See, I never said 7 days a week. What I said was, what's important to me is that the man have a relationship with God. I said, I'm very active in church. So for me, a man coming to, either going to church or maybe he's not in church anymore, but he's looking for a church home, I'm not going to discriminate for that. But for my standard, he got to go to some type of church. I mean, have a relationship with God. That's just for me. Everybody is different. But I never said 7 days a week because then it becomes imbalance. You got to have balance. So I'm not talking about 7 days a week. I'm just letting you know, church and God, that's for me number one.
Amen.
We have one last question or comment about the weed.
I just want to say in regards to having hair extensions, not every woman is able to go natural. We have some medications that are taking the hair out. We have some alopecia and some other things that are going on with women's hair that they have to or choose to wear the weave. And not only that, there is discrimination on some jobs. If you go in, there was a Supreme Court case that went before the Supreme Court that the lady, she had dreads, and they decided not to hire her, and the company won because they don't want the dreads, they don't want the natural hair. So I can say that if there is a session with weed that you have, like they said, an alter ego, or your life is dependent on this weed and you're nobody without it, then there's a problem. But if you have any underlying issues and you must wear your weed, my suggestion is you get the weed. Not to wear a weed, then maybe the woman with the weed is not the man, the woman but the man.
Amen. Yeah. But I commission that will allow you to grow it in certain places and stuff. We may bring the confidence. Okay, we have a new question. You ready? This is for you, King Kevin.
Yes, Queen.
Okay.
I'm King, brother. Brother Lamar, how you doing, King?
I'm doing well. Doing well, thank you. I actually have two questions. One directly for yourself, King Kevin, and the other question for the panel. My question directly to you is, in chapter 2 in your book, you had discussed the eagle. And I never had heard that before.
Okay.
I mean, to me, seriously, it's very interesting to me. So if you would, could you please expound and explain to us, how did you come up with the ideology? And for the panel, my question to you is, what is the role of the man and the woman in a relationship?
Okay, two parts. Let's hold two, right? Let's go to one. And tell us about, first give us the insight about the ego and the throwing up the stick.
Okay.
And that, diving that, forward.
All right, let me stand up for this one.
All right. Yeah.
He's talking about the chapter 2 of my book, Seven Types of Queens, King Desire, the ego test, right? The ego's test is a test that the female egos, when it's time for courtship with the male eagle, they put them through a test to see whether or not they are valid or whether or not they're worth their time, which is something that a lot of our sisters, our queens, aren't doing when they're dating a man or a grown male, because not every grown male is a man. It's just being truthfully told. So what the female eagle does, when she sees that a male eagle has interest in her, she takes a stick and she flies up in the air with it for a few feet and she drops it. And what she's doing is, she can see if he can catch it before it hits the ground. Now, if he catches it, then they can continue the courtship. Now, if he doesn't, then she flies away. Now, let's say that he does pick up a stick. He catches the stick, he flies back in the air, and gives it to her. So she goes back down again and gets a bigger stick. Now, she gets that bigger stick. He has to catch it, bring it back in the air even higher, to meet her where she's at. Now, when he does that, she goes down and drops it and picks up, this time, maybe a small log. Her eagles are very big. Anybody ever seen an eagle's nest before? Well, even in person, they're huge. Two grown adults can actually stand in the eagle's nest. That's how big their nests are. These are huge birds. That's why they plant their nest on the highest peak of where they're at, so they can see everything. And they also eat everything fresh, by the way. So I guess they like good food, too. Now, when the male picks up that bigger stick, now sometimes it can be a small log, because birds are very strong, especially the eagles. He has to fly possibly about, I want to say, 500, 700 feet in the air to bring it back to her. Now, what she's doing, she's testing whether or not he's consistent, is he strong enough to protect her and their future family, and whether or not he's a man of his word, meaning that is he someone that she can depend upon. And so that's one of the things that I truly know and believe that's a problem in our community. We aren't testing each other in the right way. We might test each other masculinity or femininity, but not necessarily whether or not we have the endurance, strength, and can be depended upon. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, I'd like to bring up our last panelist that just got here. He had a gig earlier. Comedian Chris Priester, the teacher. Come on up, sir.
Good day. Chris Priester, the teacher, relationship expert, and comedian, and teacher. Where am I?
You know what? You can answer the first question. Are we going to do this standing up?
Oh, no. Me and Dr. Tasha usually do this monthly.
Yes.
And we brought it to the panel.
Yes, we do drive-by therapy, a talk show.
Drive-by therapy, yes we do.
First Thursday, did you
just? Where are we tonight?
You're sitting on the brown couch.
I know.
What's happening?
You sit on the couch. Is it a golden chair?
No, it's not the golden chair. Okay.
I'm trying to get it moved.
Y'all are all welcome to our drive-by therapy talk show.
Les Brown.
You're going to answer.
Dr. Phil.
Les Brown?
Les Brown, Dr. Phil mode. Let's go.
Our king in the corner, he asked a question. You're going to answer it first and then the rest of the panel.
Go ahead, what's the question?
What is the role of a man and woman? What do you think?
Role?
What do you think?
It's 2017.
Of the man.
All right, we ready. All right.
What's happening? We're doing this on the couch, sir.
Well, I need to sit. You know I'm used to standing. I'm so sorry. I got bad nerves.
Okay. Welcome.
So 2017, simple. Roles in 2017 are defined by the pay stub.
Yeah.
Praise God.
No.
Oh, I'm going there. No. Let's go there. I'll teach you quick. We have women in South Florida that make good money. Let's just call it what it is. Okay? So, I'll be transparent. Let me start with myself. My old lady, a principal, I'm a teacher. Y'all know the money difference. We're not going to be crazy. You know what principal made versus the teacher. So now, that's why I'm here tonight. I have to make extra. Okay, she makes money. Now, can I expect her to do what my mama did? Come home, cook, clean, take care of the baby. The baby's 7 now. I got a 22-year-old and 7-year-old. Same old lady, I'm a converted baby daddy. Turned when I was, he was about 8 or 9, and she started going up the loud. It was a fiscal decision. It was fiscal. I tell her all the time. But I can't expect her to do what mama did if she making all that. Okay? Let's just keep it real. So that means I know how to cut collard greens, I know how to make a good macaroni and cheese because she's busy. Got a school to run. So I get off at 3:30. She get off at 7. Watch out, I be sitting home, waiting on the roll. Waiting on the roll, I'm hungry. 7 o'clock, I'm hungry. Baby looking at me crazy, I didn't pick him up. So I can't expect her to do what my mama did. That's why I say it's money, because I grew up right over here by building. So 40 years ago, I'm 46 now, so 40 years ago, somebody said, ooh, I look good.
Oh, you like, oh.
I'm sorry.
You have 3 minutes. You're over your 3 minutes.
I'm sorry, you didn't tell me.
I should have.
My bad. The problem is, my daddy, with his limited education, there was no way my mom could make more than him. He was the cement guy, he did construction. Mama worked at American Express. There was no way he could make more than her. I mean, she could make more than him back then, okay? That's just 40 years ago. Now, fast forward, now, sister's getting degrees. I can be a doctor, I can be a lawyer, I can do bad by myself. I'm doing all by myself. Tell them to come get you.
Can y'all give it up for Chris?
I'm sorry.
Who wants to answer that? Lady? Let's hear a lady's voice.
Yep.
The role of the man and the woman. It's
all right.
Oh, right here. You're looking
at we go to the crowd. It's here.
Oh, right here. Both.
Stay right here.
Both.
I'm right. I'm so sorry.
It's okay. Okay. I would just like to respond to that really quick, because I guess it's a question / comment. Can a woman truly submit to a man who makes less than her?
My girl.
Yeah. Yes, but I would like to hear your answer. Yes. She's good?
She's good.
She's good?
Yeah, she's good.
I think she's exceptional.
Because we started out together. Now, we both were teachers.
Okay.
We both were teachers. Let me stress that. We started out as me, and I said, all right, we had a boy. So I said, I tell you what, you go back and go up the ladder. I can tell Joseph something else. You go up the ladder, I got to keep the boy. I don't want no. That's chauvinistic, but I didn't want her just raising the boy.
I got you. Huh? And I think she's exceptional for that.
Yes.
I think she's an amazing woman for that. But I will say that I think the role is to support one another. I think the role is equal at this point. You have to support each other in the vision that God has given you for your marriage and your family. And I think that is something that we probably need to learn how to do better.
a woman needs to understand, yes, he may be making less than you, but it is about supporting you so that you can be greater than you are, and he is here for a reason, and you are here with him for a reason. If not, you would be by yourself, right?
So what's her answer specifically, man?
Yeah.
And the woman.
So I think it's to become a power couple in 2017. And I think our community deserves power couples. And so I think that's the role, to support one another, to be great here on the earth.
Okay. Man, just be refreshed. What do you believe is the role of a man and a woman? Your thoughts.
Okay, so this is coming from my perspective. Everybody's perspective may be different. I believe a man, because he has dual nature. First, he's a priest in his house. And of course, he's a provider. The woman comes as a helpmate to help him. That's how, when I was explaining earlier, the guy, for me, everybody's different. I'm saying for me, he has to have a relationship with God, because God gave the man the vision. Woman being that you're there to be his helpmate, help him carry out the vision. Of course, him being the covering can cover her, what God called her to do. So the role of a man is to be a priest in his house. You set the standard and the temperature spiritually in your house. If you're off balance, your equilibrium is wrong. Everything in your house will be out of order. I believe, my opinion, a man, I have to keep saying my opinion because everybody's different, your spiritual foundation has to be on point. Yes. The woman receives the vision from the man, and she helps him carry it out. And of course, you guys have to be equally on the same path, because if he's going this way and you don't feel that you're compatible to go that direction with him, maybe that's not your king. So again, you gotta have a spirit foundation. He's a priest, spiritually first. Naturally, he's a provider. So he's gonna go out there and get it to make sure that his home is taken care of.
You just spoke on something that a lot of women do not know. Like one of the sexiest characteristics that we can have as women, ladies, in relationships is to be supportive.
Yeah.
It's like being.
I'm late and just messing up. What happened? How we doing this? I don't want to just. I heard.
Mr. Hale, do you have a question? I mean, a response to what is the role of a man and a woman? And then we'll go to the next question.
Okay, I know when the Lord ordained marriage, he wanted him to use you as a couple. You got some, like she said, being a power couple, we need more power couples in the world. Because if I'm doing something and my wife is not supporting me, there's no way the Lord can use us as a couple. That's like when married people didn't go to the same church. If they don't go to the same church, the Lord cannot use you as a couple. He can use you as an individual, but he cannot use you as a couple. And I tell my wife sometimes, I say, the Lord might point somebody toward us. Not that we got it all right, that we're the perfect couple, but he said, watch them right there. They're doing some things right. They can guide you some things that you might need to know of. So the Lord needs more power couples. So if you're out there and you got a business going and you're doing something, and you're married, you need to be doing those things together. You got to be doing them together, unless it's going to be you just dragging each other behind. Because I tell my wife, even though I'm going to keep going doing what I'm doing, but the Lord can use you more if you're a couple, as a power couple. So, ladies, get in your place. And that doesn't mean that you're below the man. You're right beside him, but you're just in your place. And if you're up under his umbrella, you're covered. But if you're not up under the umbrella, you're not covered. So it's best to be up under the umbrella. As the Lord, then the man, then the woman, and then you're covered.
Gotcha. King Kevin, you got this question. Next question. How important is sex in a relationship?
A dumb question.
Would you like more?
Sex is important. I mean, sex, well, I would like to say more like a lovemaking or worship session. Because sex is like one of the most important or sacred acts two people can create or take part in. Because when you're having sex with someone, sexual intercourse, you're actually opening up a portal, whether you're opening up a portal of blessings or curses.
Because when two people come together, it's to create something. What are you creating? We look at our communities today, we have a lot of ratchet children. Right? Right or wrong? I mean, today, to today's day and age. Look at their behavior. Where did that come from? Now, these children, not everyone, not all the kids, there are some great kids out there. Now, I have some great nieces and nephews. I don't have any children yet, but I'm going to work on it soon as I find my queen. But that's only the story. But when you're having sex, there's something called STDs. Anyone ever heard of STDs?
Yes, some of us in here have probably had one or two, according to statistics.
Some of us have
not. Okay.
According to the stats.
Did you go check it out right now?
Praise God. Okay.
What made you talk about STDs?
Because most of when I say that.
Let number say so. Somebody got to say. Oh, I'm sorry. No, you finish, my brother. No, it's back to the STDs. I was just joking that somebody here by the numbers.
No, they do. According to statistics, they do.
I might have a little itch somewhere
else. They do. They do too.
But I'm going back to this equal part, that equal in your thing that we just mentioned. Even in the bedroom, you got to be equal in your. Because guess what? If she want to do it 4 times a week, and he want it 7 times a week, somebody ain't equal in yoke. Somebody going in the streets to compensate for the other days. And then, that's what's going to happen, because they're not equal, right? Because like I told my homeboy the other day, because I'm going to go ahead, since we're there, you know, I was invited. Because somebody says, you know, my old lady dog, she don't like to do certain things. I said, well, man, we go.
What are you talking
she
about?
She don't want to go down all set. She don't want to do that. I don't want my old lady down there because she got to kiss my kids. I'm just telling you, no. sharing, you're either celibate or you're settling. Okay? The sharers. The sharer knows that that man has another woman. She got a job, she got some money, she knows what he's coming over for. And then she sends him on his way. Sharer. Celibate. The last joker you gave it to didn't marry. So now you're in church talking about I don't need no man but Jesus. Celibate is usually accompanied with a spiritual man. Celibacy is always come with a spiritual awakening.
So you catch more than just diseases physically, but spiritually as well. Because if you notice,
a lot of those spirits still maintain and remain in you unless you cleanse yourself, right? Because you notice a lot of women, sometimes a guy could give her so much good dick, right, that she literally loses her mind. And then she's controlling herself.
There's a word for that. I have a client, she's dickmatized. She knows that. She uses that word.
Oh, they done broke the ice.
Meaning that she knows that she cannot continue to be with that same person, but she knows that she can't let go of the good sex. Or the soul tie, exactly.
Right, the soul tie. Yeah. And what you'll notice that their heart identity changes. They take on a whole other spirit. You know, they stop going to work on time, so to speak. So they end up losing their job. They start taking care of themselves. They start hanging around and doing things they never did before. Maybe they start smoking and drinking, which they never did before, because they ended up taking on the spirit of this guy who was literally destroying them when they think they're loving them. And so our ladies got to be careful of that, because we need to build stronger relationships, because our community needs it. That's one of the main reasons why I did this Go to Love Relationship panel, so that we can talk about some of these things, create some solutions, and get into the speed dating, which we will do shortly.
You know, that's actually a really big deal when it comes to wild dating, because whoever it is can only take you where they are, right? So if I'm building a brother up, however he's bringing me down, it's because he's taking me where he is. You guys get what I'm saying?
Exactly.
So after 6 months, somehow he's doing better, his business is doing better, or he started the business, yet I'm doing things that I've compromised myself to do due to who I have chosen. So you want to be careful of who you attach yourself to.
Definitely.
That's real. We had, ladies, how important is, or Mr. York, how important is sex in a relationship?
After that, she had something to say, but
I was saying we have the B card, or you're practicing abstinence and you've already.
I don't want to share that.
Okay.
But however, for me, I believe that a woman should wait. Only because I'm going to piggyback off of what King says. When you sleep with a guy, you take on his spirit. When you open yourself to your mate, you take on whatever trash that he got in his life that comes on you too. Because when you sleep together, you become one. Not only in the flesh, but in the realm of the spirit. So that's why you have to be careful, ladies, because I'm not talking to the guys, because women are receivers. Guys are givers, we're incubators. So whatever he give into the woman, you're gonna incubate and multiply. So if he's giving you trash, you're gonna reproduce that.
Well, let me ask a different question then, if we're not engaging in sexual intercourse, because there's a lot of bases on the field, right? So what about the sexual chemistry that's just romantic?
Oh, that's different. That has to be.
How important is that?
Oh, that's a 10 for me. There has to be some type of chemistry or flutter when I see the guy. That's very important. Very important to me.
Does he have to be a great kisser while you're dating him?
For instance, I've actually met someone though that I really liked after like 3 months.
I didn't like to kiss him. There were no butterflies doing cartwheels at all. So I let him go after him. I tried to teach. And all that. So for me, that's a true story. So for you, so kissing is important?
Kissing is important. Do I practice that now? No, I don't.
All right, because you're not dating. But it would be if you were dating. Miss Tiffany knows. How important is sex to you?
Okay, so, kind sir.
Hi.
I am celibate, and I have been my entire life. It's a definite spiritual awakening, because when I was a preteen, I knew that God wanted me to join together with a powerful man. And I wanted to receive from that powerful man, and that powerful man alone. And so I chose at a very young age to remain abstinent. And so until I married, I will remain this way.
Okay, you got a follow-up question.
Yes, sir. There's a difference. You're abstinent. You're a virgin. That's different. Celibate, she was getting loose. Celibate was getting loose and then stopped when he didn't marry. Ain't no celibate virgin. She stopped after she experienced all that good stuff. So that's a difference. You're a virgin. Crazy. I didn't know you was out.
I don't agree that there is a difference because I think it is the same conviction. And I think it comes from the same source. I think it comes from the same
place. No, beautiful.
We differ on that.
That's the slight difference. I will say it comes from the same place from a spiritual standpoint. You say
correct.
It comes from God.
Correct.
But because you're very virtuous. I like that. Celibate now, but 5 years ago they were touch, pop that. That's what they were doing, and now it's gone. You have never pop that. See, that's different. You're a virgin. They're not. They try to be virgins and say they celibate. They might not have got in it by 6-7 years, but you are not.
But can I share my conviction, what I've just described to you, wanting to receive from a powerful man, why wouldn't they be able to share that very same conviction as it was deposited to me? Why can't they?
Because they've already experienced something.
I don't think that makes sense.
Okay, I have a question. Sorry.
Yes,
this is a real question to the fellas. Because I have two girlfriends, one's 41 that's a virgin, and one is 36 and a virgin. I only know two. No, I know three.
All right.
Jesus. It's a real thing, but one's in Michigan, one's in Houston, and one's here in Florida. So I have a question for the fellas. I understand that it may be a thought of like, oh my gosh, I've never had a virgin until, obviously, maybe you were in high school or middle school, whenever you got started. But at this age, would anybody not date a virgin? Right? That's the question. And then, what are your thoughts if you were to meet a woman that was a virgin? Who's willing to share that?
You got one over here. Touch.
True. I know. Go ahead.
I'm ready for him.
Hey, you got a picture right here.
Talk to me.
Thank you. Should I stand up?
Introduce yourself, what church you go to. Get out of the spirit of God.
Shout out, bro.
My name is Kevin Homeboy, and just to answer your question, when I dated a virgin at this point in my life, I'm 29 years old. I may not look like it, but if I came across a woman, right, initially she's not going to tell me she's a virgin. They come through conversation, through multiple dates, and getting to know one another, she'll let me know that she's a virgin. If we're at a point where we're both interested, we're both attracted to each other, she tells me where she stands, and I tell her where I stand, I wouldn't mind moving forward. And if I'm serious, and she's serious, I wouldn't mind moving forward knowing that she's a virgin and waiting until she gets married and respecting that and continuing forward and see where it goes.
Thank you.
I wouldn't mind.
All right. Cool. We got another brother back there?
Yeah.
All right. Cause Tasha, I have a male celibate story. After we finish this little last piece here. What's up, my brother?
What's going on? Blessings all. Our name's Daniel. So touching on the question that she asked, she was here. Oh, there you go. You was just over there.
Yeah,
I'm the I think it's important that I think a lot of the times questions are asked in a way that we phrase the question as things that are checked off of a list, right? For me personally, I would, right? And it's not because of that particular status or that particular check on the list, but you can't check people off of a list and not at least get to know the person. Because at the end of the day, a relationship is a combination of two personalities getting together and really learning about each other and how they kind of blend together. So if you say, well, I won't date that person because she's a virgin, then you might have just closed yourself off to a blessing, right? Because that could be the best person for you. And if you, and that's not just because she's a virgin, that's anything, right? We get so caught up in the list and these checks, and then somebody who doesn't hit this one check, throw them in the garbage. Right?
Your vision board.
Yeah, this imaginary person that we make up in our heads based on what we see in the media. So would I date someone? Yes, right? Because at the end of the day, relationship is about the connection between two people, and it doesn't matter what that check is. What you really are looking for is the connection. If you throw someone away just because of not meeting that check, you might actually throw somebody who's amazing away, who might be the perfect person for you. Spend the rest of your life looking at trash. So that's my perspective.
Thank you.
Gosh.
First, quick second on the celibacy story. Yes, friend of mine and his woman waited. Yes, you know, they gonna wait for marriage. $30,000 later on the wedding, they went to Jamaica for the honeymoon. She found out that night that he don't like women. The marriage was a no before they got off the plane. So all that waiting, you gonna wait until that marriage night after you done dropped 30,000 and find out it's dry, or find out you don't have no excitement, and we don't waste any money. Oh Jesus! Oh Jesus! Oh God! That's why.
It's retarded.
He knew that before he got married.
But she did.
Right.
That's why you test drive the car before you pull it off.
That's true.
Yes,
we're
going to take a little break here. I want to announce some of the sponsors who supported this event, who made this event happen. Definitely I want to give a shout out and special thanks to our gold sponsors, Capital Funds and Tax Services. Y'all know it's tax season coming around, so make sure you go to their company, their business. They're located on Cypress Creek. Let me give you the exact address, say on the mic for record purposes.
We're gonna get money back from Trump Town this thing.
Oh yeah, we're gonna money back.
Alright, I gotta get some money back.
They're located at 1451 West Cypress Creek Road, Suite 300. You can follow them on Instagram at Capital Funds Tax Services LLC, right? Alright, awesome. Also, I want to give a shout out and special thanks to Visionary Events and Designs, Margaret Prosper. You see this one on the floor here? That's thanks to her. She does a wonderful job. They have a slogan called You Envision It, We Execute It. So check them out for social events, weddings, events like this. So definitely check them out. They have the business cards on the table, so make sure you take the business cards with you. Share with your friends. They do a wonderful job. I've been to several of their events. And they didn't have to support us, but they did. Also, I'd like to give a special thanks to Miami Talent Network, Little River Events, Mr. Lorna Schofield, and J.J. Gilbert. Mr. Gilbert is at a funeral, so he couldn't make it. But these people, what they do is they help create events throughout South Florida. And they helped me promote this event, online flyers. I mean, do a great job. And as I continue, can you grab me one of those gift bags? I'm going to get something away.
Okay, over here.
Yeah,
okay,
all right.
I got you. Behind you.
And also, before I continue with all the supporters, we do have raffle tickets, 2 for $5, 5 for $10. Brother Filton has raffle tickets. He'll be walking around saying you want to get a ticket. So we have wonderful gifts to give away. What other gift bags do you have? Who should I give this to? Who should I give this to? What lucky queen I should give this to? Matter of fact, let's get the raffle tickets. Let's get the raffle tickets in the back there, please. They're back there. Gary, help y'all with that. But I just want to give someone this. They don't have to buy it. I just want to give someone
this. Someone who answered a question.
Woo! Who answered a question on the ladies?
Well, I got to give it a lady. She don't want to say
anything. Let me
see. She was the person who answered a question.
Okay, let me go ahead.
copy of my book, Stage Play, and a t-shirt, One Woman Army. That's in my clothing line, so check that out. We also have special thanks to the Cold Media, Gary Pierre. Where Gary at? He's back there. He does internet marketing, SEO services. If you see my website, he's the one that did my website, all of them. And he's also my cousin, so he doesn't have a choice. So, I'm playing much love, brother. MVP, David Miller, most visibility providers. They do videos and graphics. David Miller's here, right here with the camera, doing his thing. He does several videos for me. We also have couples only. Where's Adrian? Adrian's in the back. He'll talk couples. He has a lot of events. What's your Instagram? Couples only?
Couples only with a Z.
Couples only with a Z at the end. Definitely check him out. I mean, he has the relationship events all the time in the churches. From Dade County, Broward County, Palm Beach County. Also, Courage to Believe International. See some of the members here. We have Daniel in the back.
Yeah.
Brother Bartholomew, David Miller. We're part of the mentoring program that we host, the CHESS program and the Black on Black Crime Solutions panel. So definitely look out for that. We have that every year. This year was our fourth one. It should be our fifth. I also give a special shout out to Dr. Tasha, the Drive By Therapy. She helps families. She's a family therapist. She does one-on-one consultations. So she has a business card on the table as well. So definitely take a card, ask her questions. Also, Bojo Seafood Kitchen. They've given away a dinner for two. Whoever wins the speed dating and the couples game that we have. So they're located in the Hammerville Road. Great seafood. I love their food. I've eaten there a couple of times, so definitely check them out. Scottview Marketing, that's my company. I'm not going to promote myself. I've done that enough. So, all right. So let's go ahead with the raffle tickets. So we do some raffle.
Now, we're going to hold on the raffle. Yes. Can we take a break for 10 minutes? And then we're going to do some form of speed dating.
So we're
going to
be, dancing? We're going to do networking.
For 10 minutes?
I got my dancing shoes on.
Oh. DJ, you ready for that?
One time for Harold. I know he got that from.
Dancing?
Oh, one second.
Don't you dare.
This suit that I have on right now.
Uh-oh. And
gift bags.
Not only
for this event. He gives me suits for each and one of my events that I buy. No, do not. I repeat, do not. What did I say?
Do not
support his business. What? Don't support it. Shop there.
Yeah.
When you go to these plazas and these malls, you shop till you drop. It's a black-owned business.
Yeah.
Shop till you drop at his business. So suits, jackets, ties, and one time for Deanna, Escape Lounge, but let us have some here.
Okay, come meet me in the back if you don't want to do some speed dating right here in the gold chair.